Okay, so let's get started. Hello, everyone. Thanks for coming by this session. There are a lot of great sessions and a lot of conflicts. I'm missing myself a lot, so thanks for coming by. My name is Paul Sokolovsky. I work for Linaro, which is a consortium of ARM CPU architecture licenses, a non-profit, and gathered to decrease fragmentation within ARM community and work together on baseline projects while still allowing for vendor-specific solutions on the top, and all that without siloing specifically for ARM platform and without causing more fragmentation in open source community in general. So we work with upstream as much as possible. And today I would like to talk about scripting languages for IoT. Challenges in using them and approaching different projects take place. So a few words about scripting languages in general. So there are many well-known scripting languages or very high-level languages, how they call them exactly. So scripting languages somehow has connotations that it's intended to be used to script like big applications and write just small applications. So it's old connotation, it's no longer true, and nowadays real big applications can be written in scripting languages and VHLL. Yeah, so the benefits is that they are easy to learn, and many people already know at least one, oftentimes more than one scripting languages. They are powerful and concise, like in few lines of code you can do a lot. So this increases productivity. There are usually well-developed scripting languages come with really big third-party library collections, which even more increases productivity. Yeah, so in some developments, and there is classification as it's, if it's very high-level languages, there are probably can be defined loosely like medium high-level languages like Java, C#, which use, for example, automatic memory management, but still strongly typed and require like a declaration of all the variables to use. And even lower than that is low-level, high-level languages, because, well, even C is probably high-level language by current standard. So in some segments, very high-level languages effectively like ousted those other high-level language group, for example, like web development. And so Java and C# definitely still are big contenders, but more and more projects use very high-level languages like Python, Ruby, JavaScript, and solutions based, for example, on C++ are just niche solutions. They exist, but they rarely used for web development, for example. Yeah, so why use scripting languages in IoT specifically? So the idea is try to capitalize on all the features I just talked about, which I used for desktop server development for IoT. And the talk not just about like server side and gateway side, but also on for device, like each devices of IoT, which means deeply embedded development. No real OS, no Linux, just some RTOS, maybe bare metal at all. Yeah, but scripting languages are high level, and do they allow fine control, and can they work in scarce resources which deeply embedded devices have? And for example, can we run a full scripting language or like useful subset of scripting language is just a few hundred of kilobytes of ROM and dozens of kilobytes of RAM. Yeah, so we can, and by now there is even a choice. It's a pretty hot area. There are a few projects we can do. So in this presentation, I specifically would like to focus on two implementations. It's MicroPython, which implements Python's three language subset, and JerryScript plus Zephyr.js projects, which implement JavaScript 5 plus Node.js subset. Yeah, so there are some vanity figures, both. Yeah, so to explain, JerryScript implements just a core of JavaScript language. It's like no input-output support. Zephyr.js project builds on top of that to provide eggshell, something useful, so you can work with hardware to input-output. And yeah, both these implementations have port for Zephyr RTOS, and that's well why we discuss a comparison. Okay, so a few words about each language, well, with my perspective. Yeah, so JavaScript appeared in 1995. And, well, it started, of course, as a browser scripting language allowed to just script web pages. And yeah, I remember, old good days when the only place you could see JavaScript in action was like Netscape pages about dynamic HTML, then it was called, and there was various examples which worked only for Netscape browser 4.0 and barely anywhere else. And for a long time, well, then other browsers picked up JavaScript implementation, but it was plagued for a long time by incompatibilities between browser and, well, API was pretty bare. Yeah, but as time goes by, when Web 2.0 was introduced, it was centered around all these dynamic scenes, and JavaScript API started and projects around it started to blossom. And yeah, so if it's good for web pages, then maybe it's good for everything. That's how Node.js project appeared, which followed the idea like JavaScript everywhere, not on just on client side and browser, but also on server side. And nowadays it's like being pushed everywhere. But yeah, there is a good saying by Abraham Maslow, who is author of psychological idea of hierarchy of needs fame. It's well known, like, I suppose it is tempting if the only sense you know is a hammer to treat everything as if it were a nail. So one criticism of this JavaScript everywhere approach is that, well, it tries to push a language which was initially designed just to script web pages to everywhere and treat it as a golden hammer and approach any problem with how it started initially in browsers with many limitations. Yeah, so Python is appeared 4 years before JavaScript, so it has a bit more history. And yeah, it started like a standard language which you run just from command line on your system, be it Linux or Windows, or macOS. It was supported different operating systems almost from the start, and was multi-paradigm from the start, so it was used for scientific computing. Its main author is a physicist, worked in CERN initially, where Python was written. And used for system administration, that web development, mostly, of course, server-side development. And it's pretty easy to learn initially language used in education, etc. Yeah, so it never was like number one on any language list, but usually in number five, and yeah, a lot of people know it. Yeah, Python community is very, very prolific. There are different different implementations written right for this more than almost 30 years. Yeah, and I mentioned JavaScript problems. Yeah, Python has its own problems too. To mention one, it's like Python 2 versus Python 3 split. So Python 3 is newer version. It was upgraded. Some syntax was changed. And there are still split in the community because Python 3 was released like 8 years ago. But Python 2 is still well supported, and well, some part of the community don't even want to upgrade due to good support of the old version. Yeah, okay, moving closer to embedded in IoT, one of the myths I keep hearing and like a lot of people expecting that you can take all the wells of software written for scripting languages and just put it on embedded systems and like reuse. Yeah, that definitely hardly can be the case due to very big difference in the scale of resources. So for example, like a typical deeply embedded system still has like 16 kilobytes of RAM, and this machine I present from has 16 gigabytes of ROM. So there is 1 million difference in RAM available, and RAM is by and large the most precious resource for scripting languages. So most useful software would likely be written from scratch for deeply embedded systems in these languages. But of course, all the skills could be reused, and maybe some support libraries could be ported, not written from scratch. Yeah, but with all in mind that we can't use the software as this, but implementing some a particular language is definitely easier if target language is small. And JavaScript is has better feature set here, or smaller feature set, so it's easier to implement a JavaScript engine virtual machine because of smaller feature set. And for example, JerryScript project actually implements complete ECMAScript 5 standard, which is still like two generations behind the latest ECMAScript JavaScript, which is 7. Yeah, Python has its model like better as included, which means that it packs a lot of functionality. It packs a lot of functionality in the language, and there are even really big West standard library, so you can write a lot of applications just with standard library. But of course, for our use case, it would be a like drawback, and it's not realistic to implement entire Python language. Only some subset makes sense. Yeah, but there are drawbacks in being small language too. For example, if we're going to another extreme, there is like a language which we abbreviate BF, which effectively implements just a Turing machine. Yeah, you can look up, but I'm sure a lot of people heard about it. Yeah, by the way, I'm very sorry. Can you hear me well? Because, yeah? Great. Virtual machine implementation is very simple, but developing application is very challenging. So if it gets too simple, like too small language, that it actually gets harder for a human to program it. So it's, and another issue with small languages is that there are a lot you need to rely outside of the core languages. And for example, there was an interesting hit in JavaScript community when some package, like literally dozen online package, was pulled from its standard location, and it broke thousands of packages. I don't know. I didn't follow this case. It just I googled it up again, and it's just journalists' titles. But you see how it's presented. So being too small has a problem. Being too big also has a problem. So nice idea for language for IoT, for deeply embedded IoT, would be finding a sweet spot. And yeah, so different languages, implementations which we review here go for its own sweet spot. So for example, from most complex, it's complete Python implementation. MicroPython tries to be subset of that. Then JavaScript, the core language, is even smaller. You can go even smaller with Lua. I don't follow discuss specific implementation, but there are more, of course, more than JavaScript and Python, of course. And well, complete extreme is BF language. Yeah, but if we go beyond just the core language, there are standard libraries. So with ECMAScript, there is no standard library, only language. But to realistically use JavaScript, ECMAScript, there is still a standard library. Even in browser, there is extension, not just a language, but some models, some libraries. And when you add standard library to picture, it gets about the same, whether it's Python or JavaScript, that only subset of standard library can realistically be implemented. So example, that while JerryScript implements complete ECMAScript file language, Zephyr.js, which builds on top of it, implements only subset of console specification. Maybe it will be fixed in the future. Maybe not, but realistically, no complete API from Node.js can be put into IoT because, well, Node.js is a few megabytes, and we are talking about hundreds of kilobytes of code. Yeah, so that was already talking about different paradigms, different of approaches of languages, MicroPython versus JavaScript plus Zephyr.js. Another point or dichotomy to work to decide is what we develop language for. Like, on the one extreme, you can have just main function written in scripting language and everything else develop in C. It's of course like degenerate case, it's not realistically useful. So no language implements on that. But another case is that we trying to allow to implement even the lowest level operations, like all operations in high level language. And that's actually MicroPython way. So it tries to do as much as possible. And for some platforms, not currently for Zephyr, but for some bare metal platforms, it allows, for example, to write interrupt handlers in a high level language, to initiate any low level operations like setup DMA and all that stuff. Yeah, so MicroPython's idea is to be general purpose language. Like Turing complete, you can do everything in it. And how it's being developed is that we usually start from smallest things and build bottom up functionality on top of that. Yeah, and Zephyr.js, from my point of view, yeah, I didn't mention that I actually co-maintainer of MicroPython, so I know it pretty well, and I'm contributor to Zephyr.js. So I know a lot of MicroPython, and I'm still learning Zephyr.js, but I tried to do my homework very well before the session, like contributed more or less sizable code. So yeah, and from my point of view, and Zephyr.js is still pretty young project, it's probably like maybe 9 months in development and probably less than half year as open source project. So it's still young, it's still developing, but my current outlook is that it starts to from the middle approach. Like it skips some basic functionality, for example, standard TCP, UDP support code, but for example, added open Connectivity Foundation, OCF bindings before that. And yeah, another dichotomy of the same question, what we develop language for is either we support one specific product, one specific board, I don't know, for example, Arduino 101, Or we're trying to write a core language implementation which can be ported well to any board, something like that. So definitely each project initially starts, viable project starts which was trying to do something working for just one platform. But MicroPython has a aim to be a generic language which can be ported onto any almost any, well, how I formulate MicroPython runs everywhere, and we're trying to achieve that and provide common APIs, etc. And Zephyr.js currently officially supports, so it runs on top of Zephyr RTOS, which already supports like a few dozens of boards, but it itself supports just two boards officially. It's Arduino 101 and Freedom board K64. And my actually interest in making Zephyr.js support more boards. And Linaro's interest. Yeah, so let's talk about it. That MicroPython has different target support. We started with bare metal support for STM32, and with support for Linux port. I talked about that, but Zephyr. JS so far officially supports this. It's already possible to run it on any Zephyr board due thanks to patches contributed by me, but only basic GPIO support is there. So you can make a blinking demo to show that something works. Yeah, so important part of existing part of both projects is Linux port. And so both projects have it. And for MicroPython, it's very important part because that's part where regression to suite is being run. Because deeply embedded hardware is different. People have different hardware. But like big system, Linux system, for example, everyone has it. And that's a place to develop in comfort and also run the suite in comfort. And Zephyr.js also has Linux port, but it is somewhat under-maintained currently, and I myself even don't know exact direction what to do it. So I'm trying to use my experience with MicroPython in my understanding and approach and contribution to Zephyr.js. So I think Linux port is being important, but it currently in pretty flaky shape. Like you run any script, it doesn't quit. Like it goes into infinite loop, and so it's really hard to use it. And I don't know what exactly project wants to do it, because one way maybe not spend effort on Linux port, and instead, for example, to use Node.js. And I heard that from Jeff, Zephyr.js project leader. So yeah, I don't know which way it would go. More about testing. So both projects have test suite support and continuous integration on GitHub. Both hosted on GitHub and use Travis CI. Also, in MicroPython, we also measure coverage and fight for coverage and have pretty good coverage for an open source project. So it, when I wrote this, it was 97. Now it, due to refactoring, dropped to 96.5, something like that. But yeah, we maintain it like that. JerryScript project has also a comprehensive test suite. For MicroPython, it's possible to run this both on Linux, but also on target. Yeah, there is not so big coverage on targets, on embedded targets, but it's still possible to run it. JavaScript have very good also comprehensive test suite, but I didn't see option to measure coverage, and it's not possible to run on device, the suite on device. For Zephyr.js, it's still information stage. Like I submitted a ticket about it, like how to use the suite for Zephyr.js, and since that there are big improvements, but it's still not possible like type make test and get the test. So you would need to reverse engineer a bit how it works, and it's on my to-do to follow all these refactors. It would be nice to have like easy to use facade for that. Yes, so how default development environment is structured. So for MicroPython, tries to follow upstream CPython, big Python project as closely as realistically possible. So we have default mode is interactive prompt, like you connect via UART and you start typing. And we also have Python language is peculiar that has new lines in white space important when for interactive use it maybe a bit of chore, but we have auto indent and auto completion support to make that easy. Yeah, so Zephyr.js default modes of operation is that you take your application, JavaScript application, and build complete image to flash and it runs. Yeah, there is interactive mode for Zephyr.js a shell, but yeah, to my shame, I still didn't try it, so I cannot say how good it is because, well, it's somewhere in the background, and I'm actually a bit afraid to try it because I'm afraid that it works only on Arduino 101, and I work on Freedom Board. I don't know if that's true, but I'm just afraid to get dragged into resolving those issues. We'll have another. Yeah. So MicroPython also has this mode to bundle user application, like for production deployment. Yeah. So. That was more or less high level comparison of paradigms and approaches. And yeah, going further, I would like to delve into more detailed comparison of languages and implementations too. Yeah, so how languages, including scripting languages, differ is strict versus weak typing. Yeah, so almost all scripting languages are dynamically typed, like you can do not declare type of variable and can put into any variable any type. But some languages have types associated with values. Well, all have, and Python specifically is more strict than other scripting languages usually. So for example, in Python, you cannot subscript array with a float. It's an error, it doesn't make a sense, and Python errors on that. Another interesting example is concatenating string and integer. Yeah, so you see in different scripting languages, the result is different. Like in JavaScript, it takes a type of left operand, and in PHP, in right operand. So it's if you work in more than one language, you can end up with errors if you are not careful. So and on API level, so JavaScript also has only one numeric type, which is floating point number, and Python offers separation between integer and floating point, which for deeply embedded systems could be and definitely is a good point that you, when you write code, you can know exactly are you operating on integers or floating points, and of course there is performance difference because deeply embedded simple microcontrollers don't have native floating point support. And it's interesting, so JerryScript has on its internal level separation between store and integers and floating point, but it's public API, which is recommended to use and which, for example, Zephyr.js use, it reduces everything to just floating point number. So it's like external API, I don't know what to say, deficiency or just straight. Yeah, MicroPython at all can be built without floating point support. Yeah, and also continuing that idea, it's hierarchy of variable strictness. So for example, in Lua, also for comparison, you can take non-existent variable and like use it in expression and it's not error. Like it's special but valid value. In JavaScript, this case, which is valid in Lua, leads to error, but you still can access to non-existent property and it gives valid value, not error. Yeah, so in Python, all these are errors. So it's more strictly a typed language, which also closer to completely strictly typed languages like Java, C, C++. Yeah, so and in them, of course, everything using runtype is error, but you need to declare everything very, very carefully. And in case of Java, so with very long name usually. Yeah, comparing container types. So again, as I mentioned, JavaScript is conceptually simpler language. It has just one container for all cases that you may need. It's called object, and it's used to represent objects, dictionary, and even arrays. Pure ECMAScript 5 specification, when you create array, actually it involves, accessing it involves conversion from integer to string keys. In Python, there are well-defined and single-purpose containers. For example, there is list, which guarantees or from one access, like constant time access, and there is separate dictionary, and objects are also separate, so implemented on dictionaries. Yeah, differences in memory management. So MicroPython is solely garbage collected language. Yes, because it's the most efficient way, you don't have any extra overhead in storing objects. So no reference counts, no pointers, nothing. JerryScript uses combined GC plus reference count. Well, it's known that reference counting alone is not enough for general purpose scripting languages because loop and reference would lead to not collectible things. So they use reference counting and GC too. Yeah, so reference counting also used by full CPython implementation. And so there are definitely like benefits from using reference counting that you usually can free up memory a bit earlier than with just pure GC, but also it requires storage for reference counters, and it complicates API a bit. And yeah, I know that because, well, Zephyr.js is like only recently, so to say, get the reference counting well, and we discussed with Jeff again if it makes sense to optimize it, but yeah, the response that yeah, no, that's crazy. No need to optimize it. Let's do it simple way because otherwise it's very easily to get into errors. Yeah. So other advanced things which JavaScript has is compressed pointers. It's like can use just 16-bit for storing object pointers, but for some kind of objects it can reduce memory requirement in half, but also limits heap size to half megabyte. Yeah, it's probably okay for just IoT usage, but drawback in language which cannot scale. Behave, for example, I don't know, maybe in next year we have 1 megabyte as baseline, or maybe 2 years from this in microcontrollers. Yeah, but they solved it and it's possible to use 32-bit pointers. We also would like to implement compressed pointers in MicroPython, but didn't get to that because, well, its optimization and doing it prematurely can complicate further maintenance. Yeah, and also, per my not very deep research, but there was chunking implemented in JavaScript, which is another very interesting optimization technique used to fight the fragmentation, which is a big problem. I stop on that later. But my understanding is that it was removed apparently because of complications with maintenance. Yeah, and actually the biggest challenge any scripting language faces on a constrained platform, like deeply embedded, like each IoT use cases, is memory. Yeah, so scripting languages call for like easy style to write applications, where you don't care much about memory management yourself. It's supposed to do automatically, and it's easy to write code which does a lot of allocations and collections, etc. And memory fragmentation is the biggest issue for writing like real world long running applications in scripting language. And it's actually, of course, not a scripting language problem per se. It affects any system which uses dynamic memory management. And that's why, of course, RTOSs and deeply embedded software tries to use statically allocated pools, objects, etc. Yeah, that's the way. Default way for Zephyr RTOS works, and but with scripting languages we definitely need dynamic allocations. That's well one of the biggest point of using scripting languages is not to care about that memory allocation and let interpreter VM do that. Yeah, and one way to resolve that would be to use compacting garbage collectors. So it's a very well-known technique and used in 60s of previous century for various languages. But developing it well and for more or less big in functionality language. So initially, such implementation, all the garbage collectors, etc., were prototyped for Lisp or Scheme languages, which has very small domain of operations. For bigger languages, even JavaScript and especially Python, it would require a lot of work to get it right to develop it. So that's definitely something which we would like definitely to look into MicroPython. I don't know, so didn't hear so far much from people actually using JerryScript or Zephyr.js in real projects. So I don't know if core team knows about memory problems, but my expectation is that would be as more people start to use it, they will surface, and it will require some attention. Yeah, so it's a big task to implement a more advanced garbage collector, and we are waiting in MicroPython for stakeholders. It's like maybe 1 man year or 1/2 man year, so it's a long work. You cannot do it like in your own free time. Somebody really should need it and assign you to it or pay for it or whatever. But we are trying to improve no allocation support in Python, and Python is good for that it supports no allocation operations and like in place operation. It has memory view objects which allows it, and we are trying to improve on that. Again, I don't know how grave this problem for JavaScript and Zephyr.js. I'm sure that core team faced cases with they ran out of memory, but was it fragmentation or just trying to put too much into RAM? It's yet something to have a look. A few words about Hadoop API. So it's easy to implement some APIs functionality when we just inherit them from upstream languages. So they are just like well known. We just need to find what subset of them we implement, just cut something extra pieces which don't fit. But when we hit APIs which are not well supported in upstream languages, like for example, Hadoop Access API, it becomes a big problem. Currently there is somewhat common approach in both MicroPython and Zephyr.js, and I was pleasantly surprised to see it in Zephyr.js, that they both use object-oriented approach. Like for example, GPIO pin is real object, you call methods on it, and it's easy to understand conceptually and possibly extend, etc. Because many other languages, for example, Lua, other JavaScript bindings, I saw use functional approach where pins are identified just by numbers and you call functions on them, and it's less easy to extend. Well, I know that Zephyr.js rewrites the hardware code, or there is branch with a new API. I didn't have a chance to look at that, so I don't know how it changes. But the fact that it's hard to implement hardware API, it requires various approach. In MicroPython, we fight with that last year and a half, because a lot of bike shedding, different people want different things, we cannot stabilize, but we are moving, but slowly, very slowly. Zephyr.js is pretty young, but already have a rewrite of that API. So yeah, that's another problem, big problem beside memory management. Yeah, so yeah, I guess we can pause here. Other questions? Because 10 minutes left. Per my own opinion, Go is not a scripting language. It's more or less classical compiled language, probably on the level of Java, which has automatic memory management, strongly typed, but compiles to native code. And I didn't hear about Go port to deeply embedded hardware because its runtime is pretty big for that usage. It's in contrast to Rust, which actually growing, its usage seems to grow into embedded space, but it's still compiled language, relatively low level. Yeah?
So, sorry, like a very high level question. Are you running an interpreter VM and actually interpreting a script, or is there a compile time process to turn it into native binary code?
There are both. Yeah, there was a slide on that. So default mode of operation for Zephyr.js is pre-process, pre-compile into bytecode, and then ship, flash, and run that. But it has interactive mode. For MicroPython, interactive mode is default. You start with that.
Okay.
But you can also like optimize it to run one specific application.
Okay, but like, it's much harder to, in a sense, obfuscate Python code than like JavaScript.
Yes, it's essentially, well, it's of course not the primary purpose, but for example, when this support was merged, support of such feature was merged into MicroPython, I personally was a bit concerned because it's not like wide open source community needs that essentially. It's like particular vendors which tries to do a specific product would be more interested. And it's still not like there are still things to improve, and it would be better if like it was completely implemented based on some specific request based on some contract and then merged. But well, it's needed to maintain feature parity with other languages. Well, it depends on what you mean by explicit memory management.
Avoid all your problems with garbage collection by forcing the programmer to once again worry about memory.
No, so Python has support for in-place operations. They are a natural part of language and they fit pretty well and you can do a lot, but not everything. For example, string manipulation is inherently like dynamic memory reallocation. So, if you work with strings, you will allocate memory. But if you work with buffers, it's a similar concept to Go. Like, I can say that some features from Go are taken from Python, but there is like some also parity. But yeah, it's definitely an optimization. You would initially write in standard style in Python, and then if you have problems, you would optimize. If it works as is, then there is no optimization. But if you run out of memory, if you want to do a lot on MCU, yeah, You can, with Python, you can, MicroPython, you can optimize.
Can you prove to yourself that if you restrict yourself to that subset of Python, for instance, garbage collection won't occur in an IRQ?
Yes, we have a specific set of tests in our regression tests, which like we disable GC and then test some operation, and yeah, so it's, yeah, it's regression tested. Again, I can very well talk about that for MicroPython because I'm part of that for a few years and have only basic ideas about JavaScript. So for MicroPython, it doesn't ship a complete standard library like CPython does, but there is a separate project, also part of the project, which is provide all the modules in standard Python library one by one. And these are, sometimes they are dummy, like we just reserve space but don't implement it. Sometimes they are written from scratch, but some are actually imported from CPython, and sometimes it work at all, sometimes maybe a couple of lines changes. And for me, it was important point to prove that we actually develop a small but Python implementation so we can run real Python code. Yeah. And we probably, okay, 3 minutes. Okay, then just conclusion. So, conclusions on approaches. So, JerryScript implements the whole ECMAScript file language. But yeah, fairly speaking, it's not too much, but it's important checkpoint. Yeah, MicroPython seeks to find a good sweet spot of supported subset of Python 3. Yeah, both languages in either case implement just a subset of, I'm sorry, I didn't answer about JavaScript, your question, libraries. Yeah, so one interesting point, just as this reminded me, is that one of tests which JavaScript developers use is running SunSpider JavaScript benchmark. Yeah, so it's more or less big JavaScript code, and it runs on JavaScript. It's like with big heap, but it runs. Yeah, we can run standard Python benchmark. It's PyStone. Yeah, but it's one small benchmark. We didn't try to run much more than that. Yeah, so MicroPython offers strictly typed and good inventory of types. JavaScript is weakly typed and just one object, but universal object. Yeah, and the point that currently ECMAScript 5 is supported by JavaScript, but work on adding features from further ECMAScript standard versions in ongoing, and for example, recently ECMAScript 6 typed arrays were merged. Yeah, so UPy MicroPython tries to be like look and feel of big CPython, but Zephyr.js tries to be like production ready from the start. Have that feel. Yeah, and memory management is definitely the next big challenge. I expect it would be the same for JavaScript-based project, and I don't know. I would expect it to be more problem because, yeah, it lacks all that fine-grained details and separation of Python, but we will see. Maybe reference counting does make a difference. I don't know. And it's general conclusion that, yeah, if you think that JavaScript is universally is one and only choice for IoT, yeah, there are other languages, other choices to also be aware. Yeah, for example, MicroPython, but there are many other languages. Again, I review JavaScript, Zephyr.js, and MicroPython here because they work support Zephyr RTOS, which is new, exciting. RTOS, we hope, would be Linux of deeply embedded world. Yeah, and of course, don't try what I say here. Yeah, I try to be objective. I don't know how good I was on that, but I would be definitely biased because, well, I'm a co-maintainer of MicroPython, and I do it even in my own free time while I contribute to Zephyr.js well, in my employer's time. So give it a try yourself. And both projects need contributions, and it's not just contribution to the code base. We really need people to start writing applications and then tell us what they find, the issues, good, bad, what we should do. Yeah, and if you're not convinced and prefer to keep writing in C, yeah, it's pretty good. Yeah, both projects are written in C, but it's just, I guess it's fair to say that we write in C to write less in C in the future. But we definitely, C is important language and we keep writing in C. Just a little bit, like, yeah, and if you like MicroPython, tell my boss so I can work better on it. Okay, thank you.